Venkat for inviting me. Actually, Venkat and I have been in conversation for over 2 years when they were testing the beta version of this archive, and I used the Veronica Rodriguez letter, actually, which apparently I hear has gone viral now. And I used in a performance called The Reading Room, where I invite people to bring letters.
So this evening, what we're going to do
is look at this archive in a way that is very personal, which is not institutional. May I request people at the back to come in front? Because this is sort of a really intimate, fragile experience. It's not really a performance where, you know, it's top heavy. So just come closer, come sit in front with us, make us feel warm. I would really, really appreciate that. Fill up the seats in front. Yeah, can you come in front? Come. The reading is there. Do you want to fill up some of the seats here? Second row, no takers? Perhaps? Okay. Y'all can leave also from the second row, no problem.
Okay.
This is as far forward? Okay. So let us swallow themselves in seconds. Revolutions can and often have begun with reading. Arun.
I find this line extremely powerful, and
for the last 2 years, I've actually been looking at reading as an act that is performative, where people are actually reading in front of others, in front of strangers. In my show called Lady Anandi, I break the fourth wall very often, and I read. I'm really interested in what reading does to people, what collective reading does to us. And because I'm interested in reading, and I'm interested in a form of theater called documentary theater, the document is extremely important. I find archives sexy, as crazy as that seems. I find documents exciting to engage with, and
I find documents
performative. And you will see examples of some of that today. Some of it might work, some of it might fail. We've also tried to play with documents. We've tried to be a little bit playful and irreverent, but not disrespectful, yeah? So we will be reading, and we hope that you are engaged listeners. The other important thing for this evening and for my work is the way we read documents. And that reading, I extended to reading of the archive. How do I read this fantastic archive that you have here? You know, that has amazing documents of Obaid Siddiqui, history of science, very, very important milestones in scientific history in the country. But I'm not a science person. I dropped science after the 10th standard. So then what was I interested in? Why did I get interested in this archive? I was interested in reading this archive as a place where there's a human encounter, where
the performer, because my
essential training and practice is of an actor, is of a performer.
What happens
when a performer encounters documents? So we will be sharing
some of the
encounter with you. So a human encounter with documents. There's a very interesting essay by Walter Benjamin called in the Role of the Translator in Illuminations, where he says, documents have an afterlife through the mode of translation. So I'm looking at us
as
performers
who are translating this document.
Can they have a life of their own? And finally, the idea of this evening is to look at the archives through an artistic exploration, through performance, through body,
through voice.
And I often get asked, how can performance be an act of archiving? Because a lot of my work,
like Venkat said,
is I look at myself as someone who intervenes in the archive. Lady Anandi is the story of my great-grandfather,
and he was missing
from the archive.
So I write
fiction around it. Reading room is gathering letters
of common people,
and not an archive about 100 letters. Can performance be an act of archiving? That's
the question we're going to try
or attempt to answer in the next 50 minutes. And that question bothers me, and it bothers people in the audience, and I urge you to think of the archive as something not permanent, not a fixed institutional space that's unchanging, but perhaps something that's impermanent,
that moves.
That's fragmented.
And it's like memory.
Because
what is the archive? The place of memory. And like memory,
it's bound to fade. to change shape. And this is what I find really exciting about archives. Its quality to change, to fade, and to remain unfixed. These are thoughts I'm throwing at you, and let's explore it together over the next 50 minutes. And I'll come back to this quotation at the end and
tell you who wrote it, etc.
But I'm going to read it. What seems the most ephemeral and fragile may in fact be the most enduring. Flesh fades, diminishes, and dies. On the breath and through the performing body, story keeps its airy lightness and flooding force, suggesting one possibility of life beyond death. In this sense, memory endures. Paradoxically, because it moves. Only through movement can memory take up residence and build a dwelling place within us. As sites of accumulation, we become shelters or living archives for memory. Our bodies hold a myriad of incomplete pieces, the presence of which we are sometimes unaware. I hope that we can all, through the next
1 hour or
so, think of ourselves as these incomplete pieces as we witness the performance. Burning the Old Year, Naomi Shihab Nye.
Letters swallow themselves in seconds. Notes, friends tied to the doorknob. Transparent scarlet paper, sizzle like moth wings, marry the air.
So much of any year is flammable. Lists of vegetables, partial poems, orange swirling flame of days, so little is a storm.
Where there was something and suddenly isn't. An absence shouts, celebrates, leaves the space. I begin again with the smallest numbers.
Quick dance, shuffle of losses and leaves. Only the things I didn't do crackle after the blazing dies.
So as an artist who was encountering this archive, I decided to create a map for myself. And I used this poem
as a map
to negotiate
the archive.
I often find that when fiction and archival documents collide, something fascinating starts to happen. We don't know where the boundaries of what are, what lies where. So that was quite exciting to me, and I start with this poem as a map. So what did I look at when I came to the archive? I looked at letters. I looked at time. What was time doing? The extent of time, the shortness of time. I looked at notes. I love notes. I looked at their notebooks that were in the archive. I wasn't looking at awards or big lectures that Obaid Siddiqui was giving or fellowships people were receiving, but I looked at really small things. I looked at notes. I looked at letters. I looked at paper. I looked at the browning yellow paper, transparent paper, paper that might crumble, paper that the archivist has with so much love and care tried to preserve and hold on to. So I looked at paper. Air, I want to give this whole thing a lightness of air. I hope we can achieve that. Lists. Scientists love making lists. I mean, there was no dearth of lists in the archive. Categories and categories. But the lists that I chose are of very mundane things. That might give us insight into some of the people whose lists I've shared. So not heavy lists, very simple, everyday lists. Poems, I haven't found poems. Flame of days, I hope we are blazing together. And then the idea was to create emotions of what is it that might shout out at us? What stands out in the archive? What can we celebrate? And finally, the thing about absences. What leaves a space? Is there something that's absent from the archive? Is there a loss we need to mourn? So what is left behind? The idea of death is also quite implicit. Again, I begin with the smallest number. So I was looking at little things that might be ignored when people go to the archive. So I wasn't looking at the fancy, very nice equipment. I wasn't looking at that. I was looking at maybe postcards. I was looking at bills. I was looking at notepads that had only first three pages. I was looking at postcards that had been unsent and unnamed, that were just lying around. So I looked at small things. Also, what's important through the whole evening is the idea of I. Where do I stand? How do I approach this archive? And yes, finally, the idea of death. If we hold the archive in our body through our breath, then what does death do? Does the memory die with a person dying? So you will see a little bit of the letters that we read, and the images that will be shown to you might
touch upon
some of this. So here's what I looked at in categorization.
I looked at ephemera
within the archive. And when I looked at ephemera and I gave it to him,
said, ah,
ephemera, you know. So ephemera, people that things people weren't looking at. Personal correspondence, unnamed, undated. Again, for a space of science, everything is well categorized, well species, subspecies, subcategories. So the idea of unnamed, anonymous, blank was very exciting to me. Lists, of course, I said. And Naomi Shihab, Burning the Old Year, is also about the passing of a old year, and they're standing at the threshold of a year that's going to come. So obviously I wanted to look at greeting cards that people were sending to each other saying, Happy New Year, have a joyous year. So this is a bunch of ephemera that we used. And what I also used this evening is a bunch of letters that I used and I've gathered in reading room. Because what happens to documents that are in this archive? Can they breathe? Can they talk to other letters from other worlds? Can the worlds come together? Can an Obaid Siddiqui letter stand next to a letter of two friends writing to each other? How do the various letters communicate with each other? A little bit crazy and geeky in my head, but so I brought in some letters that I've gathered in my reading room as well. So that's the plan for the evening. That's what we're going to do.
The scene. Hostel room, barely furnished. A lady sits at her wooden writing desk in her nine-yard sari, a mangal suit made of flag beads around her neck. Large pearl earrings don her ears, hair oiled and plaited into a bun at the nape of her neck. No makeup mars her face except for a large bindi at the center of her forehead. She seems vulnerable but confident of her future as she writes on, her pen dipping into the inkstand at intervals. Anandibai Joshi is determined but not aggressive in her letter. She seems hopeful. A light breeze comes in from the window, brushing the soft curtains aside. The smell of incense sticks from the corner of the room rises.
Roselle N.J., June 18th, 1883. Alfred Jones, Germantown, Philadelphia, Pasadena. Dear Sir, I beg to ask if upon any terms pecuniarily consistent with my means, I may be allowed to enter the Women's College of Pasadena for a thorough course of study. I have with me $70 and my husband expects to send me $20 per month, less the cost of sending. I was 18 years of age last March. I have been once through English grammar, have studied through arithmetic in my own language, and as far as division in English, I am now pushing forward in this as fast as I can. I have read the histories of England, Rome, Greece, and India. I have learned to read and speak in seven languages, including Marathi, my own, Sanskrit, Bengali, Gujarati, Hindustani, and English. Though I may not meet in all points the requirements for entering college, I trust that as my case is an exception and peculiar, your people will be merciful and obliging. My health is good, and this, with that determination, which has brought me to your country against the combined opposition of my friends and caste, ought to go a long way towards helping me to carry out the purpose for which I came, that is, to render to my poor, suffering countrywomen, the true medical aid they so sadly stand in need of, and which they would rather die for than to accept from the hands of a male physician. The voice of humanity is with me, and I must not fail. My soul is moved to help the many who cannot help themselves, and I feel sure that He, God, who has me in His care, will influence the many that can and should share in this good work to lend me such aid and assistance as I may need. I ask nothing for myself, but all that is necessary to fit me for my work. I humbly crave at the door of your college or any other that shall give me admittance. For the kind encouragement already received and the hopes held out, I feelingly subscribe myself, yours gratefully, Anandibai Joshi.
The scene. Sound of a typewriter clacking and telex machines working continuously. Smell of cigarettes and the sea. Sound of a man dictating a letter to his secretary. As you enter, you see a wall-to-wall maroon carpet, teak paneled walls, teak furniture, tube steel chairs, world maps showing sea lanes of Jayashree shipping, founder's photograph framed with garland of flowers and diya. Series of framed awards for JSS given by government bodies, models of JSS ships in glass cases, placed on sideboards. Typist hard at work typing official letters, cigarette in ashtray by her side, at far end in glass panel cabin, middle-aged man with thick rimmed spectacles, smokes and drinks coffee, and studies an official document.
Jayashree Shipping, Embassy Center, 7th floor, 207 Nariman Point, Bombay, 400021. Telex 0116071, AB JSTIIN. Grants J Ships. Phones 230260, 230990, 241477, 241680. December 18, 1980. Captain P.P. Kandalgaonkar, Krishna Building, 20 G.S. Lane, Parel, Bombay, 400012. Dear Sir, we are pleased to inform you that we will be taking delivery of the vessel M.V. Eve in Far East around mid-January 1981. We take this opportunity to request you to please join the above vessel, which still under the present owners, at Kenai, Alaska, as an observer to be able to familiarize with the same before finally taking command of the vessel at the later date on official delivery of the vessel to our company. We request you to kindly make out comprehensive report on your observation during the voyage. Your service condition will be as per your original appointment letter dated 31st July 1978. With best wishes, yours faithfully, for Jayashree Shipping, Captain N.H. Sadrangani, Marine Superintendent. Leave expired on 10th December 1980. On staff in Bombay from 11th to 18th December 1980. Staff aboard from 19th to 21st. Joint VLMV Eve on 22nd.
Morning, 9:30 a.m. Veronica is in mid-30s.
She is wearing a crisp cotton salwar kameez, sitting at her office table, typing the letter to the dean on her typewriter.
There is a cup of coffee on the table, untouched.
She looks out of the window, seemingly to collect her thoughts.
Starts typing, sitting with her back straight, brows knitted, and mouth set in a straight line.
January 1st, 1990. Professor R. Vijay Raghavan, Dean, Physics Faculty, TIFR. Dear Professor Vijay Raghavan, I feel that appending Kumari, Srimati, or Miss to the names of women scientists in official correspondence is not only unnecessary but also unacceptable. This practice should be stopped unless you consider qualifying men scientists with Sri and Kumar. Thank you for your attention. Sincerely yours, Dr. Veronica Rodriguez.
That name might be familiar to some people here. Next, we come to lists. Of the many lists that Obaid Siddiqui made, there's a very quirky list of all the CDs he converted to MP3s. These run into pages and pages, and we decided to have a little bit of fun because it's a music list. We've chosen two lists. Should we begin?
Artist.
Radha.
Index.
Coffee from.
Shujat Khan.
Sri.
MP3 9. Nikhil Banerjee.
Malcolm dot MP3.
MP3 10.
TD77.
Nikhil Banerjee.
Bilashkani Todi dot MP3.
MP3 10.
TD39.
Nikhil Banerjee.
Pilu dot MP3.
MP3 10.
TD38.
Nikhil Banerjee.
Bhatiyar dot MP3.
MP3 10.
TD38.
Nikhil Banerjee.
Urvi Kalyan. MP3 10.
TD34.
Nikhil Banerjee. Marga. MP3 10. TD34.
Nikhil Banerjee.
Hem Vihar.
MP3 10.
TD151.
Nikhil Banerjee.
Chandrakant.
MP3 10.
TD151.
Nikhil Banerjee.
Nat Bhaira.
MP3 10.
TD150.
Nikhil Banerjee.
Niyam Bisodi.
MP3 10.
TD150.
Nikhil Banerjee.
Rajeshri dot MP3.
MP3 10.
TD13.
Nikhil Banerjee.
Desh 1/2.
MP3 10. Lakshmi and L. Shankar.
Kirwani dot MP3.
MP3 10. Kumar Gandharva.
Nirguni Bhajan.
MP3 10.
TD70.
Bhimsen Joshi.
Marva.
MP3 10.
TD70.
Shahid Pardes.
Google.
You can clap for them, they deserve it. I wonder what Obaid Siddiqui might think us disrupting it like that, but it was fun. Another person, Krishnan, also, we accessed some of his diaries. I haven't used it enough, but he had great doodles of elephants, and there were very important passwords written alongside the elephants and the doodles, so I won't show it. But another list that Krishnan made was of all the students of people who borrowed books from him and made them sign when they took the books and made them sign when they returned the books. Again, there are pages and pages of this logbook. We've just taken out one page. Are any of your names there? People you know, recognize, don't know? Do you still have his books? Okay.
Letter dated 8th Feb 1929 from ACN Nambias, Berlin, Charlottenburg, Berliner Street 66. To his wife, Suhasini Nambias, B5, Napier Road, Fort Bombay. My dear baby, in my last week's harried note, I had informed you that I would be writing to you in my next letter about what I referred to as a new development in my life. You have a shrewd suspicion as to what this is. I shall be frank and brief. I have come to care for another girl, Bavarian, deeply. And with her, I'm living in the full sense of the word. She's about your age, perhaps, a little older, capable and clever.
Considering the nature of our relationship, this new turn in my life, if so may I call it, is not likely to change, affect, or in any way modify my feelings towards you. But at the same time, it means that in the future we will have to live separately. It is not likely that I will come back to India in the near future, nor at any rate for another year. There is no reason for this news to disturb you. I don't feel like writing much more today. Kindly inform Lester and Gundu. Yours is always, Nanu.
Gundu's reply to Nambia on 8 March 1929. Baby received the first of these after a long time. She broke down and wept and said, "You're not coming." The child talks of you and you only. She has been very ill and still in very bad health and being miserable over unemployment. But you have, in my opinion, dealt her a death blow. Affectionately yours, Gunnu.
Park Hotel. Hi, sweetheart. How are you? भाई वक्त के साथ साथ हमको भी भूल गए या now you don't remember me? Anyway, I remember you a lot and miss you. How's Bombay? How about your new job? Here in Delhi, everything is fine. I'm studying and got nothing else to do. Smita, please let me know about the new and interesting things happening in Bombay. And what happened to the D store in Dunlop House? Please write if there is something that will interest me. Aur bata, kya chal raha hai? Oh yeah, I met a girl here who looks exactly like you. And I went to the disc and what fun! She started jumping like you. Believe me, I missed you so much. Par hai re meri kismat. Chal boss, I have nothing more to write. Please keep in touch. Oh, convey my sexy hi to Mr. Ghosh. And please send me his letter, his address, meherbani. कभी तन्हाई के लम्हे में मुझे याद कर लेना मैं गुजरा वक्त नहीं हूं जो लौट न सकूं कन्वे माय रिगार्ड्स टू एवरीवन विद लॉट्स ऑफ लव एंड विशेस अपूर्व 15 पार्लियामेंट स्ट्रीट न्यू दिल्ली 110001 टेलीफोन 3732477 कलेक्ट 0316523 टेलीफैक्स 3732025 दिल्लीज बेस्ट लोकेटेड लग्जरी होटल
April 09, 1980. Dear Apoorv, it was a surprise to hear from you. I thought you must still be upset with me after the last conversation. So, what do I write? Bombay is fine. I joined Indian Airlines 6 months back. You know how much I love to travel. I fly the East sector a lot. Sometimes I get to stay overnight in Calcutta, visit Dada. Oh, he recently had a baby girl, did you know? Apoorv, I'm sorry about how I reacted last time. It was too much of a sudden and unexpected thing. मैंने तो हमेशा तुम्हें मेरा भाई माना है. अब भी मानती हूँ. बस. I hope you understand. Let's stay in touch if possible. You can write to Dada at 43/1 Jagta Plain, Bhavanipur, Calcutta. Best wishes, Smita Ghosh.
Like I said, I was looking at notes and notebooks, and this is a notepad that I found, and only the first 3 or 4 pages of this notepad Obaid Siddiqui has written, and for such a fine mind, I find this list very, actually peculiar. It's a list of all the computer commands. Yeah. Do you want to try to play with this document a bit?
F1, help, F2, edit, F3, paste name, F4, repeat last time, F5, go to, F6, next page, F7, spell check, F8, extend mode, F9, recalculate all, go to, activate number,
F11,
name new call,
F12,
save up,
controller,
file open,
alt F1,
insert chart,
alt F2,
save as,
alt F4,
exit, Or that line.
Use your basic editor.
Control I.
Enter current time.
Control semicolon.
Current date.
Control double.
Copy value from
control
cell
single
above.
Code.
Copy formula from cell above.
Control F7.
Move window.
Control D.
File down.
Control Z.
Go to.
Control
A. Place.
Control
C. Enter hyperlink.
Control Y.
Repeat.
Repeat. The next document that I'm about to share, I have no idea what those documents are doing in this archive. They are bills, piles and piles of bills of restaurant orders and letters of Bombay Gymkhana. And y'all might know Obaid Siddiqui as a person who made path baking research on the fruit fly. Is that right? Yeah. I know him as a man who loves chicken chop suey a lot. He ordered fresh lime soda all the time and hot and sour soup and sweet corn chicken soup. These three menu items reappear on those bills. We pulled out only two bills. Look at the bill for yourself.
The repeat menu item, one prawn American chop suey, one hot and sour soup, one chicken spring roll, one sweet corn wet soup, one sweet corn chicken, extra container, extra charge.
One more bill. And suddenly there's a letter that we read by Obaid to Bombay Gymkhana.
Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, National Center for Biological Sciences, GKVK Campus, Bangalore, 560065. Mr. M. Venkatraman, Secretary, MG Road, Fort, Mumbai, 400001. Telephone 2207031. Dear Mr. Venkatraman, thank you for your letter of 27th October 2003. I wish to resign my membership of Bombay Gymkhana. Kind regards, sincerely yours, O. Siddiqui. Membership number S629.
The next set is again a bunch of unnamed, unsent postcards from Obaid Siddiqui's collection. There were postcards that were not written on, possibly he collected them on his travels. And again, I find it fascinating that any information on them is absent. So that's another absence that I wanted to include in this.
Wednesday, 20th December 2000. From Shozan Zia, ZIA@cshl.org, to Obaid Siddiqui, osiddiqui@ncbs.res.in. Subject, regarding strong repellent odorants. Dear Professor Siddiqui, thank you very much for your comments on my inquiry. I will probably try some aldehydes and alcohols very soon. Hopefully, I can make the assay work reliably soon and be able to rescreen a candidate learning memory mutants, over 100 stocks. My goal is to find the different mutants with defects in discriminability and perception, sensory acuity in a normal learning and memory assay, and even off-action processing pathway components. My second hope is to test discrimination at the level of mushroom bodies, the antennal lobe and even antennae. Especially for MBs, I am expecting to dissect discrimination and learning processes if MBs are not involved in discrimination. If you know and or have GA14 lines with specific expression in antenna and antennal lobe, please let me know. It is very likely for us to have a collaboration on these ongoing projects. With all the best, Shozan.
Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, National Center of the Government of India for Nuclear Science and Mathematics, Bangalore Center, TIFR Center, postbox number 1234. Indian Institute of Science Campus, Bangalore, 560012. Telephone 3344062, 3343138. Telegram astromath. Telex 0845-8488. TIFRIN fax 080-334-3851. National Center for Biological Sciences, January 31st, 1997. I, O. Siddiqui, handed over charge of Director, NCBS, in the afternoon of today, January 31st, 1997. O. Siddiqui, Director. I, K. Vijay Raghavan, assumed charge of Director, NCBS, in the afternoon of today, January 31st, 1997. K. Vijay Raghavan, Director, officiating.
From Vijay at ncbs.tifrbng.res.in, 3rd February 1997. Professor O. Siddiqui, NCBS, Bangalore. Dear Obaid, today is my first working day as a new director of NCBS, and I felt that I should write to you many of my thoughts that are difficult to express in person. First of all, I was inspired to work in biology by an article on temperature-sensitive paralytics that you wrote, Genetics Blocks in the Elements of Neural Network in Drosophila, Raven Press, New York. I was visiting G.P. Talwar's lab in 1997, recovering from tuberculosis that I contracted during the emergency when I was politically active and campaigning for the restoration of civil liberties. Strangely, although the elections were over and in many ways what we fought for was achieved, I felt lost about what I wanted to do next. I had decided to go to Zurich for my PhD in biomedical engineering and was admitted to the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology in Zurich. But I was not sure that this was what I wanted to do the most. I chanced upon Talwar's book in the reading room and read your article from beginning to end and was pleasantly surprised to find that I understood it. I thoroughly enjoyed the approach and decided that neurobiology was what I wanted to do. Subsequently, when I appeared for the research scholar interview, I was sure that TIFR was the place for me. In all my years at the molecular biology unit, I have always felt stimulated, comfortable, and was given the intellectual space to develop in my own way. This I value greatly, and the environment that allowed this feeling is due entirely to you. Since my return from Caltech in January 1998, we have been involved in development of NCBS. During the course of these activities, I have sometimes felt that we should have taken a different route. On all these occasions, I have found that I was wrong to be impatient, that your long-term perspective was both correct and essential. I hope I have learned from you in these matters, and I'm sure that I will continue to benefit from your advice. In dealing with the other outside world, I have learned from you and benefited greatly from the perspective and protective umbrella that your presence has offered and continues to do so. I'm very happy that Asia and you will be moving to Bangalore soon and that you will be developing your laboratory there. Although it goes without saying, I would like to stress that I look forward to a close interaction with you in developing NCBS and that I assure you of every help in growing your research in Bangalore. With warm personal regards, yours, Vijay.
Good morning. I would not be around when you read this letter. Don't get angry on me. I know some of you truly cared for me, loved me, and treated me very well. I have no complaints on anyone, It was always with myself I had problems. I feel a growing gap between my soul and my body. And I have become a monster. I always wanted to be a writer. A writer of science like Carl Sagan. At last, this is the only letter I'm getting to write. I always wanted to be a writer of science like Carl Sagan. I love science, stars, nature, but then I love people without knowing that people have long since divorced from nature. Our feelings are second-handed, our love is constructed, our beliefs colored, our originality valid through artificial art. It has become truly difficult to love without getting hurt. The value of a man was reduced to his immediate identity and nearest possibility. To a vote, to a number, to a thing. Never was a man treated as a mind. As a glorious thing that made of stardust in every field, in studies, in streets, in politics, and in dying and living. I am writing this kind of letter for the first time, my first time of a final letter. Forgive me if I fail to make mistakes. My birth is my fatal accident. I can never recover from my childhood loneliness, the unappreciated child from my past. Maybe I was wrong, all the while in understanding world, in understanding love, pain, life, death, there was no urgency, but I always was rushing, desperate to start a life. All the while, some people, for them, life itself is cursed. My birth is my fatal accident. I can never recover from my childhood loneliness, the unappreciated child from my past. I'm not hurt at this moment. I'm not sad. I'm just empty, unconcerned about myself. That's pathetic. And that's why I'm doing this. People may dub me as a coward and selfish or stupid once I'm gone. I'm not bothered about what I'm called. I don't believe in after death stories, ghosts or spirits. If there is anything at all I believe that I can travel to the stars and know about the other worlds. If you who is reading this letter can do anything for me, I have to get 7 months of my fellowship, 1,75,000 rupees. Please see to it that my family paid that. I have to give some 40,000 to Ramji. He never asked them back, but please pay that to him from that. Let my funeral be silent and smooth. Behave like I just appeared and gone. Do not shed tears for me. Know that I'm happy dead than being alive. From shadows to the stars. Uma Anna, sorry for using your room for this thing. To ASA family, sorry for disappointing all of you. You loved me very much. I wish all the best for the future. For one last time, Jai Bhim. I forgot to write the formalities. No one is responsible for this act of killing myself. No one has instigated me, whether by their acts or by their words to this act. This is my decision, and I'm the only one responsible for this. Do not trouble my friends and enemies on this after I'm gone.
Professor and Mrs. Siddiqui. All good wishes for joy and happiness in the new year and good health. Lokita Varadarajan, S. Varadarajan.
With best wishes for Christmas and the New Year, Walter and Julia Bodmer, Principal's Lodging, Hertford College, Oxford.
Be joyful with the intoxicating flowers, those which are in our hands. Now put on the necklaces of flowers. Our flowers from the season of rain, fragrant flowers, now open their corollas. There flies the bird, he chatters and sings. He has known the house of God. Only with our flowers we are happy. Only with our songs does sadness disappear. Happy New Year, dear Obaid and Asya. With love from John and Beltina.
Season's greetings and best wishes for a joyous holiday, with all the kindest wishes for good health and good fortune throughout the year. Ken Ichi and Naoko Arai.
Season's greetings, Kunwanti Godig.
Birds and flowers of our Alibag garden, join us in wishing you good health, happiness, and a great new year. Swan and Fakir Kohli.
Abstract on two themes, 1962. With best wishes for a happy new year. Mehrangir 12, Little Gibbs Road, Bombay 6, December 1963.
Omi Ba. Just to close with this again, what seems the most ephemeral and fragile may in fact be the most enduring. Flesh fades, diminishes and dies. On the breath and through the performing body, story keeps its airy likeness and flooding forth, suggesting one possibility of life beyond death. In this sense, memory endures, paradoxically, because it moves. Only through movement can memory take up residence and build a dwelling place within us. As sites of accumulation, we become shelters or living archives for memory. Our bodies hold a myriad of incomplete pieces, the presence of which we are sometimes unaware. You hold those incomplete pieces, and thank you very much. We kept time. I really want to thank my performers and Venkat for allowing me access into this fantastic archive. It's a fantastic archive.
Thank you, guys. This was fantastic. We'll take a few questions from the audience. If you guys want to talk to them about process, or if you want to contest some of their interpretation, this is, you know, open ground.
Yes. Hi. I have a quick question on context, because letters depend so much on that. Mm. As an artist, right, when you're looking at fragments, how does that sometimes fare with context, because sometimes it's that which gives things meaning?
Right. That's a great question. In the reading room, I'll just describe to you, because it's a very specific notion of context. So in the reading room, I invite people to bring letters, and you know, people bring personal letters and they read it alongside ones I've curated from the public domain. So in a particular reading room, you may have brought the letter and you're a stranger to me. I don't know you, but we read the letter aloud together and we know, I look at your face, there's your person present there. And at the end of the reading room, I ask people to donate those letters to me for the next reading room. So when we read it the next time, that person is absent. There is no context. And it's this idea of what happens to this document without a history. But I also do think that the document in and of itself sometimes carries context. The dates, the phone number, the overwriting, the remarks, the quality of the paper. I actually find this notion of no context quite romantic also. Like somebody came, they read, and now they're absent, but the document exists. So I'm okay working without a specific context of who is this, where is it coming from, because it allows for interpretation. Because the next time it's read, it could be read by a man, if it was a woman writing. And that change in voice is quite fascinating. Actually, I'll give you an example. There was a letter of abuse a girl brought. And the next time it was read by a man, and it became quite powerful. It was like he was admitting his guilt without knowing that. Yeah. Does that...
Anyone else? Could you... I mean, we've talked about the reading room quite a bit, but I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about your curatorial thought in the stuff that you took, and perhaps the stuff that you left behind. What did you decide not to include in this, I mean, in today's performance, the things that you wished you'd included, or the things that you decide this doesn't work? You know, how are you thinking about what goes next to what?
How did I discard some of? So I asked Venka to scan lots of material for me. I will return it if I can digitally undo it. But yeah, I asked for a lot of material. There were some posters, there were articles on Binayak Sen. I used large chunks of it. So Venkat, I decided on the material by giving it to the performers. So just to say, today's lecture performance, I didn't want to come here and stand and talk. When other people come, they show charts and they show graphs. So the documents and the performers are my material. That's what I work with. So I wanted to illustrate some of it. So I put it in the fold. I mixed it up yesterday while we were trying to rehearse it to see what sounds right, what might excite them, what was the narrative of the entire evening. And the poem was the narrative for me. The poem made me decide what I will discard. So like a newspaper article of Binayak Sen, there are many articles, didn't fit, didn't sound right. Though as a material for this kind of evening, a newspaper article would be very exciting. So I decided to discard it. Some of it, like we read a few letters yesterday, which today we decided no. It was also intuitive. I mean, for me, it's just by listening and playing. We were really playing. So yesterday, after play, we said, oh, this may not make sense, this may make sense. So we encountered the documents. Like there were photographs that I took. I took very beautiful photographs of Veronica Rodriguez, which I did not want to use, because I hadn't seen Veronica Rodriguez until last week. And I've been using her letter for 2.5 years. So the description you all read of her, we had written last September. We don't know what she looked like. So I wanted to keep it like that. I don't want to put an image to that. We had imagined, so that's the intervention or the collision of fiction and fact. So we left Veronica Rodriguez's photo out. Then there's a beautiful blue-tinted photograph, which is very powerful visually, but we don't know who those people are. We were like, will we be being gentle towards their context? We wanted to read the breakup letter on their photograph, but we were like, what if they've been married for 50 years and their grandchildren are here? So some of those things were slightly ethical questions, so we said no. So there was a process of trial and error in performance. Yeah, that's what, like, that's what we were doing yesterday. We were just...
Can I just add one thought to it? That,
you know, there is a public persona of someone as big as Dr. Siddiqui, right?
Yeah.
Everybody knows his public persona. But to see that menu, you know, like, it sort of gave a little bit of an insight into his person. Who is he as a person, right? It was interesting for us to think, you know, it was nice to bring that in. So it gives you an insight of something you would never know otherwise. And I'm interested in food and, you know, just what people are eating and drinking and gossiping about. That listening to, that's not official documents of them. So, yeah.
Anyone else? If nothing else, it should probably make you very careful about the letters you write to. but please don't be careful. Sorry, that was not the intent. Please be carefree.
Please, yeah. We were very worried today to play with the music list. We were like, can we do Bhavan, Bhavan, Bhavan? There's a group of scientists. You know, we're all dressed in ways, at least me, that you would never find me in, but I wanted to be taken seriously, so thank you. To beholden myself to this place.
Give me some context about that. Before the performance today, Anuja and I had a little chat, and she said, we were very playful yesterday, but when we came to campus, we decided to sort of just go a little serious, and we sort of toned down the playfulness of what we did. So that is the impression that we are exuding, apparently. So, we need to sort of dismantle that.
No, we kept the play. We kept it. We pushed it a bit, but we kept it. Yeah.
All right.
Thank you. One last thing. You know, since the form I work on is so niche, kindly like my Facebook page.
I'm sorry, I have to say Twitter and Instagram. Please, thank you
very much. I hope that's okay.
You may want to mention the...
What's the handle?
Yeah.
At Ghosalkar Anuja. Yeah.
Sorry. No more questions. Thank you again.